Hi, everyone. Thank you all for joining us today. I'm Elaine Christian with the City of West Palm Beach Office of Sustainability, and we are so excited to be partnering with Loggerhead Marinelife Center today to chat about sustainable seafood. We have Katie with us today, and she is the conservation manager with Loggerhead Marinelife Center. If you have any questions during the presentation, please drop them in the chat box and we'll have Q&A at the end. Keep in mind that if you like today's program, we have many more scheduled. You can always visit wpb.org/green to view our upcoming programs. I will also be sending out a follow-up email after today's presentation, which will include the recording in case you'd like to share it or watch it again. And now let's transition to Katie so we can get hooked on sustainable seafood. Katie, I think you're muted.
Hello, I'm so sorry. Trying to share my screen right now. And after we get that done, we should be all good if everyone can hear me now. Can you guys see my screen at least?
Yes.
Perfect. All right. So thank you all so much for joining us today. My name is Katie O'Hara and I am the conservation manager at Loggerhead Marinelife Center. I would first like to thank the City of West Palm Beach's Mayor Office of Sustainability for having us. We are so excited to be talking about sustainable seafood, one of my personal favorite topics ever. And we're really excited to have you join us. So thank you so much again. And let's dive into getting hooked on sustainable seafood. For those of you who don't know, Loggerhead Marinelife Center is a nonprofit sea turtle hospital and rehabilitation center located in Juno Beach, Florida. We are a nonprofit facility and we are open to the public 7 days a week. We are free, so come on down and enjoy our sea turtles someday if you have not already done so. Loggerhead Marinelife Center is comprised of four main departments, and those are some main areas that we focus on when it comes to sea turtle and ocean conservation. So we have our education department that focuses on our educational programming, tours, and they cater to adults and children alike to educate them more about our ocean's ecosystems and our sea turtles. And we also have our research department. I don't know if you all have seen them cruising the beach in Juno Beach and Jupiter, doing their nesting surveys, but they're starting to get really busy again this year. I believe we have about 7 leatherbacks that have already come up, but there might be more since I've last checked. So they're already starting to get busy, and keep an eye out for our Respect the Locals campaign that we're running. We have some really fun stickers and stuff to kind of remind everyone that the turtles are the real locals around here. We also have our conservation department. So our conservation department develops and implements comprehensive conservation solutions to man-made threats facing sea turtles. That is the department that I'm in. So basically we try to keep the turtles from having to come into the hospital in the first place. And then finally, we have our rehab department where all of the sick and injured sea turtles come in for treatment. At Loggerhead, we have no resident sea turtles. All of them are actively going through rehabilitation. They're all patients and they'll all be released back into the ocean once they're well enough to do so. So the age old question slash quote, for decades, there has been the saying, there are plenty of fish in the sea. And that was kind of taken literally. The ocean was thought to be kind of an inexhaustible resource, and it was thought to be kind of limitless, endless, boundless, right? So the question today is, there are plenty of fish in the sea, right? Or are there? So we're actually quickly realizing that this is not really the case. With the demand for seafood getting higher and higher each year, fish populations are actually really struggling to try to keep up with the catch rates. So with the advancements in technology, with the boats that we now have that can stay out on the water for really long periods of time, fish populations are really just trying to keep up with us. So in 2018 alone, 96.4 million tons of fish were caught in our oceans. And over 1/3 of commercial fish stocks that are being harvested are being done so at actually biologically unsustainable levels, so levels that the fish cannot keep up with. So we're quickly realizing that no, there aren't plenty of fish in the sea, and that there's something we need to do about it. So what is overfishing? Overfishing is when too many individuals of a species, specifically a marine species, are caught at a rate that the overall population cannot keep up with. So the individuals that are left in the ocean cannot reproduce at a rate that is quick enough to keep their population steady and in line with the catch rates. So when a fishery is overfished, there will be maybe a few individuals left, but they can't repopulate fast enough to keep up with the hype. With fishing, over 3 billion people actually depend on seafood globally as their number one protein source. So they really depend on having this access to seafood and having actual fish in the sea for them to be able to utilize. So large predatory fish, so we're thinking our salmon, our tuna, our marlin, the big fish that you think about, they are the ones that are most susceptible to overfishing. So with these species, they have pretty long lives and they're pretty slow to reproduce. So when they're being caught at unsustainable rates and their populations decline drastically, they're not really able to repopulate at rates quick enough. So when that occurs, it starts at the top of the food chain. And then something called fishing down the food chain will occur. So when there are no more of those predatory fish, or those predatory fish get very scarce, fishermen will start targeting the fish at lower levels of the food chain that might be smaller and maybe easier to, maybe have an easier time keeping up their populations. But once you start picking off levels of the food chain, you're creating a chain reaction that's going to work all the way down to the bottom. Those little fish species are also really important for other marine life in our oceans as a food source for them. So our dolphins, our marine mammals, our sea turtles, our sharks, they depend on these fish as well. So when they're being overfished, those fish are going, or those marine species are going to suffer greatly as well. So this kind of has a trickle down effect, and that will actually end up having countless additional impacts on our ecosystem. And if you think about it, overfishing is actually really devastating to the fishing communities as well. So they definitely don't want to be doing that. If there are no fish for them to fish, their livelihood's gone. So it's really important to them as well to keep overfishing from happening. So as you can see here at this cartoon, you give a man a fish, he eats for a day. Teach a man to fish, he eats for a lifetime. Overfish and nobody eats. So bycatch, we talk about overfishing, but something that's interesting that's going on and pretty sad is this bycatch. So bycatch is when non-target marine species are being caught in a fishery and these species cannot be kept or sold. So they're accidentally just caught up in these nets because fishing gear, as we all know, is clear. It's made specifically so it's very hard to see and very hard to avoid. So people can catch as many fish as they can, but that makes it really detrimental to other species. So bycatch is actually comprises of 20% of the marine species that are caught annually in fishing and discarded. So bycatch is a really big issue. It's estimated that at least 7.3 million tons of marine life are caught as bycatch annually. And for some fisheries, that actually will outweigh the amount of actual target fish that they're collecting. So the target fish will be caught in less numbers than the things that are discarded. These fishing methods are actually not very gentle on these fish. So when the bycatch is brought up, it's usually not in very good shape and unfortunately not going to survive. So a lot of the bycatch, unless it's caught very early on, is just pretty much a wasted fish or a wasted marine life. So for example, if methods to reduce bycatch aren't in place, because we do have some solutions, they're not perfect, but shrimp trawl fisheries are one of the biggest sources of bycatch. And it's been found that up to 75% of the fish in one haul can be bycatch as opposed to the actual shrimp that they're targeting. So this is a really big issue and something to consider when you're talking about sustainable seafood. So those non-selective fisheries like longlines, trawling, gill nets, they have some of the highest bycatch rates. And we'll talk about that a bit more later on, but that's one of the main issues with wild caughts. Aquaculture is a really interesting thing and it's emerging all the time. So the aquaculture industry has actually grown significantly in the past probably 30 years. And now it's actually providing nearly 50% of the seafood that we're eating. There used to be kind of a stigma against aquaculture and farmed fish where people are like, it's not the best option. But actually nowadays with refined methods, aquaculture can be just as sustainable as wild caught fish if it's done correctly. These aquaculture farms can be land-based or they can also be found in pens in the ocean, almost like cow pens, but just out in the sea. So by just adopting those responsibly, those environmentally responsible actions that we'll talk about in a little bit, farmed fish can be just as sustainable, if not sometimes more sustainable than the wild caught options. So now that I've bummed you all out pretty badly about the bad stuff that's happening, what is sustainable seafood? Like, what exactly is it? Sustainable seafood are seafood items that come from sources that have either stable or increasing populations. So when those fish and those species are taken as food, they're not having a negative effect on the population or on the ecosystem around it. So these are the different kind of factors that are considered when deeming a seafood item sustainable or not. We're gonna talk about in a bit a lot of the different kind of recommendation organizations that exist and the different types of like certifications that you can find. And these are a lot of the recommendations that they take into consideration when they are making their evaluation choices. So for wild caught seafood, they want to make sure that these seafood items have really healthy, stable populations to begin with. They're not facing any sort of diseases that are prevalent in their populations that are taking them out or anything like that. They want to make sure that the fish numbers that are being caught are not exceeding the population growth rates. So no overfishing is occurring. They want to make sure that there are effective science-based fishery management programs in place to ensure that those fish will not eventually be overfished and to make sure that that's all being managed and monitored. They want to make sure that capture methods are resulting in very minimal bycatch, so other species are not being super negatively impacted. And they want to make sure that the fishing method has a very minimal impact on the environment as a whole. They want to make sure that they're not taking out entire coral heads while they're fishing for a shrimp or something like that to make sure that it's not harming our marine environment as a whole. In farming, it's really interesting that it also has a lot of the same things. So that environmental impact is also being taken into consideration, making sure that it has minimal impact, making sure that non-environmentally harmful chemicals and antibiotics are used. When you have all these fish together in a very close confined area, disease and different things like that can spread pretty prevalently. So they have to make sure that they are able to administer antibiotics and things like that, but they wanna make sure they're doing it in a way that's not gonna throw off the ocean's ecosystem if they're adding a lot of these chemicals into the ocean. You wanna make sure they're environmentally friendly ones. Making sure that sustainable fish feed is being used for those fish stocks, so making sure that they are not fishing their way up the food chain and starting at the bottom with the little guys, and reducing that food source to make sure their fish are fed. So that would be pretty bad for farming wise. They want to make sure that it is a native species, or if it's a non-native species that's out in the ocean, that it can't escape or anything like that. Because we really want to make sure that when we're farming these fish and keeping them in these close-knit areas, that they won't introduce invasives and wreak havoc on the ecosystem that's local. And then also they want to make sure that wastewater management systems are in place, because as you can imagine, when a lot of fish are all together, the water can get pretty nasty and they want to make sure it's going somewhere that's not going to negatively impact the environment. So sustainable seafood and climate change. So food accounts for 1/4 of all global greenhouse emissions. So if you think about the transport, the having to hold livestock, the emissions that livestock produces, all of that is creating kind of a massive storm for our climate. So many seafood items are really the best choices to be considering when it comes to reducing your carbon footprint, because there's no need for cleared land or there's no need to hold livestock in an area. So that's a really good option, but you need to be very careful when you are considering your seafood options. So we know that the ocean is a carbon sink. So that means it is absorbing and sequestering or storing about 31% of all of our carbon emissions. So we have a lot to thank our oceans for making sure that our climate doesn't kind of go crazy at a faster and faster and faster rate than it already is. So when you're choosing your seafood, another thing you have to consider is the method that it's caught. So while a lot of seafood items are really good for our environment and good for our climate, some can be actually really detrimental. A study was actually just released on Wednesday about bottom trawling. So that's when kind of these large, heavy metal nets are dragged across the ocean floor to catch little things like shrimp and crabs and flounder. So if the carbon is being dropped to the bottom and stored in that ocean floor, and then we're just trawling straight over it, what do we think is happening? We're releasing that carbon actually back into the ocean that the ocean was trying so hard to store away from us. So it was just discovered that 1 gigaton of carbon is being released annually that was sequestered on the ocean floor by bottom trawling. So to put that in perspective, because I couldn't tell you what a gigaton really like means in a real sense, that is the equivalent of all of global aviation travel for an entire year. So that's every airplane emissions in the sky for an entire year. And as we all know, reducing travel is one of the best ways you can help the planet because air travel is so detrimental. So that's a really crazy thing and something you really need to consider when you're choosing your seafood sources, especially if you're really looking to reduce your impact on the planet. So why is it so important to make these sustainable seafood choices? With every single individual, we can create little change that when we all come together creates massive large scale change, right? So when we're all making these tiny changes in our everyday lives, we can help to replenish our ocean's resources, manage and maintain these fisheries for generations to come to ensure that our children's 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 children can enjoy flounder someday, right? We want to make sure that we're choosing seafood that's less harmful to other species, and we're going to make sure that we're choosing options that are better for the marine environment and protects the marine environment and marine ecosystems. These are also often the most climate-friendly options that are available, and we want to make sure that our fishing communities can also be sustained in these endeavors, that we're not demanding seafood that they're trying to give us, but really it can't sustain. So what is Loggerhead Marine Life Center doing about it, right? We all have a part to play. So Loggerhead Marine Life Center is a partner with the Monterey Bay's Aquarium Seafood Watch Program. And this program is an amazing recommendation program that has been developed over many years to give businesses and consumers the best choices and give them the best information to make the most educated seafood choices possible. So they created a stoplight system, which makes it very easy for anyone to really see which options are the best. They evaluate their seafood on many different elements. So they look at the species, method of fishing, where the item was fished, the bycatch levels, and all the things we just talked about. And they create the best choices, good alternatives, MSC certified, and avoid lists for you. These are updated regularly and they can be accessed on the Seafood Watch website. So these are science-based recommendations to ensure that they're not only monitoring the fisheries, but also the fish populations in the oceans as well, to ensure that we are armed with as much knowledge as we possibly can have to keep our oceans healthy. So our best choices are the ones that you want to always go for when you can. These are the options that are managed correctly. They're caught or farmed in the right ways to ensure that it is a sustainable practice for a very, very long time. The good alternatives are ones that you can opt for if you must, but they are not the best options and there's a little concern there. So just keep an eye on the recommendations and make changes as necessary because they update them regularly. MSC certified, we'll talk about in a little bit, but that's equivalent to the good alternative. It's just a different organization. And then to avoid are ones that you should absolutely not buy because they are very harmful to the marine environment and they're also overfished. So they make it very easy. They produce them pretty regularly and update pretty regularly. And actually it was said by Oceana that if we were to sustainably manage all of our resources in the ocean, we would be able to feed 1 billion people one seafood meal every day for the rest of forever. So that's a pretty crazy thing if we were able to sustainably manage our oceans. Maybe they could be plentiful and bountiless if we did it correctly. So Loggerhead Marinelife Center has also worked with local restaurants to create the Blue Table Restaurant Program. The Blue Table Restaurant Program works collaboratively with these local restaurants to kind of see what is possible for them to change for the better. So we try to create a single-use plastic-free, styrofoam-free setting while encouraging sustainable seafood items to be supplied and purchased. And these are actions that actually mutually benefit both the business and the marine environment. So it was found in a study that over 50% of US consumers said that they would buy sustainable seafood at a higher cost if they knew it was sustainable and knew it was going to be better for the environment. So this is something that consumers actually want to see. And when you're providing that, it really does make a difference and people are willing to kind of pay to ensure that there will be fish still in 20 or 50 years. So it's not only important to kind of drive that change, but also to educate consumers and then ensure that that change is being driven from the producers and the consumers so we can meet in the middle and ensure sustainability. We also just wanted to make sure that when these restaurants were going above and beyond, which they all really have been, that they were recognized for their efforts because it's not an easy thing to do that research and make that make those changes. And the businesses that really are working to do that are doing awesome. And then it also gives other businesses something to look at and be like, huh, I could do that too. So these are some of our existing Blue Table partners. We're really grateful for them. And if anyone's interested in talking more about the Blue Table program, I'm really happy to provide information. We have really had a great time kind of working with these restaurants to figure out how to work together on this. So very grateful to them. We also at Loggerhead Marinelife Center, our sea turtle patients eat sustainable seafood. We partnered with Aquaco Farms of Fort Pierce, Florida, and they actually provide us with pompano as a food item for our LMC sea turtle patients. This Aquaco Farms is actually the first farmed pompano in the US and it's sustainably made. And they actually specifically provided it for our beautiful patient, Justice Ginsburg. She was an adult loggerhead. She loved her pompano so much that she actually was released and she is doing great now. Florida pompano was farmed in an indoor recirculating tank with wastewater treatment that was provided. So it is a best choice situation. So this judgy sea turtle wants to know what you can do about it personally. So these are some of the sustainability ratings that I mentioned earlier. And by educating yourself and kind of being familiar with these icons and with these recommendations, you are full of knowledge to make the right choices, right? So the Seafood Watch program I talked about a little bit ago, this is the Monterey Bay Aquarium's program. They help consumers and businesses make those choices for healthy seafood. The Marine Stewardship Council is probably something that most of us have seen in the grocery stores and on the seafood that we're purchasing pretty regularly. This is a pretty standard certification, and they just work to make sure that people know exactly what their food is, but also that it's sustainable. And then Fish Choice is a really amazing platform if anyone's interested in kind of diving in more into sustainability and seafood, because it combines all of the recommendation kind of certification programs, and you can see which ones are certified throughout, which ones are only certified Monterey Bay. I mean, it's a really good tool to be able to just educate yourself more. It's also a really great tool for businesses that are looking to make that sustainable change, because you can track your changes. You can do an audit of your seafood and see which ones are sustainable, which ones are not, and kind of work through that on this platform. So it's great. There are tons of other ones that are really awesome that exist, but these are some of kind of my favorite, and the other ones did not fit on this slide. One of the other really important things that people don't really realize when it comes to seafood and to these certification programs that are really important is that they also help us to know exactly what we're eating. So it's very interesting, but in a 2016 study done by Oceana, they actually found that 20% of the seafood that they sampled in grocery stores and in restaurants was incorrectly labeled. So whoever was ordering maybe a certain fish species was getting a completely different species. And I don't know about you, but I like to know exactly what I'm eating. So I think that that's a really good incentive to be following these programs, to ensuring that you have that traceability throughout your entire seafood process. There was also another study done by UCLA students in California where they went and they tested sushi in restaurants, and they found that 47% was incorrectly labeled. So by recognizing these different icons, you can definitely make sure that you're eating what you think you're eating, you're having that correct seafood item, but you're also holding the businesses accountable. You're making sure that they're paying attention to what their seafood item is as it changes hands, and making sure that it does not get incorrectly labeled and then charge more for something that you think you're getting. But you're also helping to combat overfishing, you're making it able to track these things easier, and ensure a robust supply of seafood for future generations. So one of the other best things you can do is obviously buy local. Over 60% of the seafood that is found in the US is actually imported, but US fisheries are some of the most well-managed fisheries in the entire world. So whenever you can buy just local fish, definitely try to, because we can make sure that these fisheries are held up to a certain standard that is necessary, but that might not exist in other places. It also greatly reduces carbon emission. If you're buying seafood from your local seafood vendor, the emissions are so much less than if they had to be shipped from halfway across the world. It definitely ensures that transparency in the supply chain, because it makes sure that that seafood item probably just passed hands maybe twice, maybe three times. And it's really hard to misidentify a fish when you have like the whole thing. So it creates that transparency. It also helps to strengthen local economies, and local food and local seafood is often the most sustainable option you can possibly find. And you can also kind of talk to those fishermen and tell them, ask them what they're doing to ensure sustainability. And I'm sure that they'd love to kind of talk to you about that. So how to choose seafood with the smallest carbon footprint, not footprint. 90% of greenhouse gas emissions from wild seafood actually just comes from fuel use. So making sure that you're doing that locally caught seafood, like we talked about last time, make sure that from across the world that fish isn't using those carbon emissions. It's just from the direct emissions right there. So that locally caught seafood is already hitting it out of the park. Small schooling fish species are one of the most sustainable and smallest carbon footprint fish that you can also find. So these smaller schooling fish species tend to be pretty clustered together. And it only takes one trip for a boat to get out there, drop a net, and scoop up those fish eliminates having to kind of drive all around and look for those fish. So they know exactly where they are, they know there'll be quite a bit of them. And also if they're small, they're pretty quick to reproduce. So that helps to eliminate some carbon too. Making sure that there are fish with healthy populations. If there are more of them out there, they're going to be easier for the fishermen to catch, right? So they don't have to be out there for long periods of time, running their engines and running their gas. So they can make sure that those healthy populations are being caught and making sure that the less healthy ones are not. And then farmed fish like shellfish and oysters, clams and mussels, those are really good options to reduce your carbon footprint. These fish actually, well, these shellfish do not actually need that much food because they're filter feeders and they get their food from the water that they're in. So no other species really have to be harmed to feed these animals, which is a great way to reduce that carbon. And also by choosing those smaller schooling fish, because they can be kind of taken quickly, just to put something in perspective a little bit more, Australian tiger prawns, which are the little shrimp, they actually can be responsible for up to 10,000 liters of fuel per catch, just because that boat has to trawl around to find those species, as opposed to the little ones that can just be gone out for one. A few of the best choice seafood options that are available are listed here. So we have our invasive species. So these species are species of marine life that are caught in non-native waters. And they're not supposed to be there in the first place anyway, right? So by reducing their numbers, you're actually doing the ecosystem a favor. So I don't know if anyone has ever had lionfish before. It is delicious. But the fillets are like this big, so you just have to catch a lot of them. But they're lionfish tacos are really amazing. So if you haven't had it, I highly recommend it. And they're actually pretty fun to catch. With this species as well, you're eliminating bycatch completely because one of the only ways they can be caught is through spearfishing. You can also do traps, but with spearfishing, you have literally no bycatch here, especially if you have just like a little Hawaiian sling. If you miss, you won't hit another fish. They're way faster. So you have none of that bycatch. With another thing with invasive species, as climate change does occur, they're most likely going to be more resilient to the impacts. So they're not going to feel those effects as dramatically as some of the native species might. So they'll probably continue to thrive, or some of them, and then by reducing their numbers further, it's better for the environment overall. Another option is blue catfish. Another one of the best seafood options are those farmed shellfish species like the oysters, mussels, clams, and abalone. They are great options because they can be farmed, and as long as they're held up to a high standard, they are doing well. And then farmed fish species are a great option. So you can definitely make sure to check and see if your farmed fish species are good, but these specific ones are great. So if they're US farmed shrimp, they're good to go. Pompano and trout. Wild caught shrimp, not really the best option, but US farmed ones are. So, and then as we mentioned, the choices you make as consumers really drive change in the market, right? So if we're demanding this change and we're requesting that these sustainable practices are enforced and we place a higher value on them, the market will shift to that. So we have a lot of power as consumers, and we can definitely help to create a more sustainable, healthy environment for our seafood and for our oceans to ensure that we'll always have it and it'll always be there. I think that this quote is really relevant to kind of sustainable seafood and really just the shift we're seeing overall in kind of recognizing how important it is for us to create nature or to protect nature, not only to create a better future for us, but also to ensure that we actually can survive alongside it. So we're really starting to realize that it is so important for us to make sure that these marine creatures and our environment is intact so we can also thrive. Everything's connected, and it's really important to just make sure to take a step back and realize that. So thank you, Jacques Cousteau. And then finally, here's just kind of a quick run through of things you can do, little steps you can take so you can help keep plenty of fish in the sea. So just ask, do you sell sustainable seafood? Do you have sustainable seafood here? Make sure that people know, businesses know that that is a priority to you. The more they hear it, the more inclined they'll be to be like, you know, I should buy sustainable seafood, because that's what the people want, right? Make sure you know the sustainability status of your favorite seafood items and make sure you're tracking that change as the recommendations are updated. Also, get to know your local fishing community. It can be really interesting to see kind of what they bring in, but also they're going to really appreciate you supporting them and kind of talking to them about their sustainability efforts. So purchase that seafood straight from the source. And then finally, make sure you're educating others about the importance of making those sustainable seafood choices, because the more of us that are doing it, the more it's going to catch on and the more change that'll come around. So simple steps that we all can take to create massive change and make sure that our seas are plentiful. So I'd just like to thank you all so much for listening. And if anyone has any questions at all, I would love to answer them and reduce your footprint.
Thank you so much, Katie. We do have a few questions. If you're fishing local, are there any additional practices to follow other than specific seasons for certain fish?
That's a great question. So it kind of depends on the type of fishing you're doing. If you're a recreational fisher, one of the things that you can make sure you're really abiding by is those size limits, because they're put in place from science-based recommendations to ensure that the two little fish that are necessary for the populations to thrive aren't taken, but also the two big fish that are necessary as well also won't be taken. Another thing you can make sure you're doing is just reducing the amount of derelict fishing gear or accidentally lost or discarded fishing gear that enters the marine environment. That stuff, as you kind of saw with the bycatch, if it's just floating around in the ocean, it's going to continue to catch seafood as it goes, or continue to catch marine life as it goes. So just being responsible with that and trying to limit that as much as possible is really important. And then also just being kind of actually, this is just boating related, but being aware of marine life on the surface. If you're ever out there, just make sure you're looking out for anything, because it's nesting season again. Sea turtles are gonna be up on the surface trying to breathe, and they're really hard to see if you're not looking out for them. So we wanna make sure that we keep them really healthy too as well. So yeah, I think that's pretty good. And just being aware of the fish species that really are doing well and not doing well.
Is there a certain website that people could visit to know that, like right offhand?
Do you mean like the sizes?
Or like, how do we know like the sustainability status of certain, like what we should be eating?
Yeah, absolutely. So the Monterey Bay Aquarium Seafood Watch website is a really good resource. You can actually go onto that website and search any type of seafood, and you'll see the recommendations for that. So they use that stoplight approach, so you can see if it's green, it'll tell you exactly what type of fishing is best, where it's from. And then the other one, that's Fish Choice, is a really good one to compare all of those. So you can make sure you're getting like the best of the best that's highly rated.
Okay, and how many restaurants are a part of the Blue Table program?
Yes. So we kind of started small to make sure that we could work as closely with the restaurants as we could and kind of make sure that we were doing things that were possible for the restaurants, the changes. So we have about 7 restaurants right now. We are really open to working with partners, helping them make that change into a more plastic-free facility. We have a lot of resources that we can help you with, and we're just open to having that conversation and helping you on your plastic-free journey and sustainable seafood one.
And that's definitely something I think for those who are listening in today, something you can probably talk to the restaurants about too and let them know about this program, because Loggerhead is just such a great resource for them to reach out to and learn from as well.
Thank you. And yeah, just to jump on that, we just want to celebrate the restaurants that really are trying so hard too, because it's not easy. It's not an easy feat. It can be with the right resources, but just kind of start off on your own, it's like, where do I even start? So we're happy to kind of make that connection, but also to celebrate the ones that are doing it on their own, because that's awesome.
Yeah, definitely. And I know through our green business challenge in the past, you know, a lot of restaurants and businesses just in general, they say, oh, it's going to be too expensive for me to convert away from these certain items. And you guys have really broken it down for them to let them know, like, hey, no, this is actually possible. I mean, you can do this, right?
Exactly. Yeah. And a lot of it really just comes with like, not like, like we've all been talking about, just not distributing things automatically. There you already save money and are helping to save the environment. So it's just little things, but we definitely work together and we are listening to you as well as a business. We would like to make sure it's as collaborative as possible because we're not pretending to be experts in the restaurant industry by any means. So we would like to just kind of work together on that.
That's great. And we have another question that just came in. What about the salmon farm in Homestead? Is this sustainably farmed? Do you know about that?
I do not. I have to do a bit more research on that because I'm not aware of kind of what their practices are. But if you shoot me an email, I can definitely, my email is on the LMC website. So I can definitely look into that for you and get that information to you. But I'd need a bit more information.
I will, in my follow-up email that I'll send to everyone, I'll include your email, Katie, if that's okay.
Yeah, please.
Okay. All right. Well, I don't see any other questions coming through, but I just want to say thank you so much, Katie, for joining us today. This has been such great information, and I think we've all learned a lot today that we can, you know, move forward with, especially when we're out looking for seafood options. So hope everyone has gotten hooked on the sustainable seafood today. And I don't see any other questions coming through. So everybody have a great rest of your Friday and a great weekend. And hopefully we will, oh, I forgot. I was going to mention our E4 Life program. I almost forgot. Let me see here. All right. So before we go, just want to mention too, Loggerhead Marine Life Center will also be at our E4 Live Green Health and Wellness Expo, which is on April 3rd from 10 a.m. to 4 p.m. at the Science Center. So the South Florida Science Center and Aquarium. So definitely encourage you all to come out. City of West Palm Beach residents do get 50% off admission this day, and there are free planetarium shows throughout the day. We have lots of free giveaways that we'll be doing, and even you know, there's going to be a program from Loggerhead 2 going on. So we have lots of great things scheduled throughout the day. We also will have a free tree giveaway that day as well. So you can register beforehand, pick out your trees, and they'll be ready to go. Just visit our website there to pick out your trees. And we also will have a rain barrel giveaway that day as well. So lots of great stuff going on. April 3rd, mark your calendars. I hope to see you all there. And this is our website, wpb.org/green. We're also on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter at WPBGreen. So give us a follow. I'll also include Loggerhead's social media and webpage and everything in the follow-up email that I send out to everyone. So you'll have all of that information. And thank you everyone for sticking with it. We're a little past 12:30, but obviously, I mean, this was really interesting. So thank you all for sticking with us and learning with us today. So have a great weekend, everybody.
Thank you.
Bye.